Here at Calvary Chapel, we believe that the Word of God, the whole Word of God from Genesis to Revelation is something to be studied for today. That everything that's contained therein has a message for us.
Okay, let's continue our study this morning. If you were here last week, we finished up all of chapter 7 in the Gospel of John. And we're going to pick up in chapter 8 this morning. And this is the story of the woman caught in adultery. It's a really loved and familiar story by most of us. The story this morning, actually there's two stories we're going to cover through this portion of Scripture. But the first one is the story of the woman caught in adultery. This woman is brought by religious people. And it's also a story about Jesus writing something. You know, this is a quote from a guy named Philip Schaff. He was a church historian. And he wrote about Jesus. He wrote that Jesus, this is a quote, "Jesus without money or arms conquered more millions than Alexander the Great, Caesar, Muhammad, and Napoleon. Without science and learning, Jesus shed more light on things human and divine than all the philosophers and scholars combined. Without the eloquence of school, Jesus spoke such words of life that were never spoken before or since. And Jesus produced effects on more writers and poets without ever writing a single line. He set more pens in motion and furnished themes for more sermons, discussions, learned volumes, works of art, and songs of praise than any other man of ancient or modern times." And that was Jesus. There's nothing ever recorded that Jesus wrote anything down, even though the story this morning is about Jesus writing something. The focus of the story this morning isn't let's sit down and try to debate what Jesus wrote. That's not the focus of the story, but Jesus did write something. The focus of the story isn't about the scribes and Pharisees that brought this woman in that committed adultery and their hypocrisy, although there is some hypocrisy there, but that's not the focus of the story. The focus of the story isn't about the woman either. The focus of the story is about how Jesus handled hypocrites and how Jesus handled gross sin. This is another story in the Gospel of John that's recorded for us to promote faith. The theme of the Gospel of John is, who is Jesus? That Jesus is the Son of God, and by believing in Him, you'll have everlasting life. Jesus is meek with sinners. He's masterful with hypocrites. And He's also merciful with sinners. So we'll start off at verse 1. Don't you love when I do this? Actually, if you have a Bible, why don't you look at the very last verse in chapter 7? Because remember, the chapter and verses were not... are not inspired. So this story really starts in verse 53 of the previous verse. The previous chapter. I don't have that up on the screen, but if you have a Bible or a Bible app, if you look at verse 53 and it says, "Everyone went to his own house. Because if I started the chapter off and I started out with the sentence like, "But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives," that would sound a little bit unusual. I've never read a novel or a book that started a chapter out with the word "but." You know, that's just not typical. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. You know, every once in a while you come across something in the Bible and he goes, so what? You think about verse 53, it says, "Everyone went to his own house." Well, couldn't we say that just about of every single day of every week? Everybody went to their own house at the end of the day? Well, why is that in there? Well, it says, well, Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Well, Jesus didn't have a house. Remember, he said that foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests. But the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. If you have never read a book by the author Gail Irwin called The Jesus Style, I really encourage you to read that book. It's a great book. It's not very long. And it's all about Jesus and the style that he came into this world. He didn't come in a fancy hospital. Remember, he was born in a feeding trough. He was put into a manger. They didn't have a fancy hospital for him to go get born in. His family was obviously poor. They didn't have their own burial plot. They didn't have a place, you know, bought in the cemetery or in the crypt anywhere for Jesus to be buried. And remember, Jesus had to be buried in a borrowed tomb. Well, he only needed it for a weekend anyway, but still it was a borrowed tomb. He didn't have anything, you know. They were poor. You know, he didn't come lavishly. The Apostle Paul tells us in the book of Philippians, Paul says about Jesus, Jesus, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God to be grass, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. That's Jesus. Jesus came to serve. I always liked the story about the guy that lived like 125 years or so ago when the stagecoach was prevalent. He was getting ready to take a stagecoach trip across the state, and he went in to buy a ticket, and he noticed that there was three ticket prices. It said first class was one price, second class was another price, and third class was another price. And he said, "Hey, can I see your stagecoach so I can see what the different class of tickets are?" He walked out, and the guy told him, "Sure, you can go look at a stagecoach. There's one out there." He went out there and looked inside the stagecoach, and he looked around. And he goes, "I don't see anything different in there." So he was just felt good about himself. So I'll take the third class. I'll take the cheaper ticket. And the guy thought, "Yeah, I just saved myself a bunch of money." Well, everything was fine and dandy until they went riding along for half a day or so. Well, then they finally got to a big hill, and the stagecoach stopped. The stagecoach driver said, "Hey, if you're in first class, stay in the coach. If you're in second class, get out and walk. If you're in third class, get out and push." Jesus came in third class. He came to serve. Remember the last thing that Jesus taught his disciples? If you think about the last night of Jesus' life with his disciples, he went into the upper room and had this little private affair. You would think, well, this is the last night of Jesus' ministry. He's going to have a big evangelistic crusade. Now, he didn't do that. He kind of did like a coach does right before the big game. They get everybody together in the locker room, and they give you that one last pep talk to get you going before the game starts. Well, that's what Jesus did in that upper room on the night before he was killed, is he had that last lesson for his disciples, and it was washing the feet to teach them to be a servant. To teach them to be a servant. Jesus came in third class. Verse 2. Now early in the morning, he came again into the temple, and all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. Notice that he came early in the morning. Nothing fancy. He just showed up and started teaching. There was no flyers that were sent out. He didn't have any angels flying around announcing that he was coming. It was just Jesus, meek and mild. And notice that also that it says that he sat down and he taught them. Unlike the way we are today, where the pastor, the preacher stands and everybody else sits, at that time, the teacher was the one that sat down and everybody else stood. So that was different than what we do today. Verse 3, then the scribes and Pharisees brought to him a woman caught in adultery, and they had set her in the midst. Okay, if you were here last week, when we were in chapter 7 at verse 32 in chapter 7, if you remember, there was some murmuring going on in the crowd, and the scribes and Pharisees murmuring about Jesus possibly being the Messiah, and people were starting to believe in him. Well, the scribes and Pharisees and the religious leaders at that time said, "No, we're not going to have this. We need to stop this Jesus guy right now." And remember, they sent the temple police after Jesus to arrest him. And they came back and they didn't have Jesus. And the Pharisees asked the police, "Why didn't you arrest Jesus?" And they said, "Oh, nobody ever spoke like this before. Well, where's Jesus?" "Oh, no one ever spoke like this before." Well, so the Pharisees have a dilemma there. So now they've got plan. This is plan B now. Since the first plan to arrest Jesus didn't work out, we've got to come up with another plan. So this is the plan that they come up with. And also, it was not uncommon at this time, if there was some type of a dilemma, and you didn't know what to do, and you needed to figure out how should we settle this. It was not uncommon for you to bring that to the attention of a rabbi and say, "Rabbi, what do? We have this or that situation. Let the rabbi decide what to do." Verse number 4. They said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded that such should be stoned. What do you say?" "The seventh commandment, you shall not commit adultery. In the book of the law, in the book of Leviticus, it says, the man who commits adultery with another man's wife, he who commits adultery with his neighbor's wife, the adulterer and the adulteress shall surely be put to death." Well, we got a problem here. Where's the guy at? If she was caught in the act of committing adultery, there had to be a guy. So this was all a setup from the very beginning. She probably, obviously was committing the act of adultery, but we really don't know for sure how this, you know, how they found out about her. And another thing, the Pharisees and the scribes and the Jewish authorities there, they hadn't practiced this stoning people to death for committing adultery for over 1,000 years. It just wasn't practiced anymore. Some people will say that adultery was just rampant among the religious leaders at the time, and they would never ever do this. But these guys think they got Jesus in a no-win situation. They figure that Jesus has two choices right here, right now. First, if he says, no, don't stone her, well, then he's breaking the law of Moses. And they say, hey, we told you this rabbi's breaking the law. And if he says, go ahead and stone her, well, then he's going to ruin his reputation as a friend of sinners. And the Romans were going to be on him. Because remember, the Jews didn't even have the right to commit to execute capital punishment. Remember how when Jesus was crucified, the leaders had to go to the Roman authorities because the Jewish leaders had no authority to actually crucify or to execute anybody. Verse 6. They said this testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground with his finger as though he did not hear. What did he write on the ground? I don't know. Doesn't say. I do know one thing. I know in the original language, the word for writing, that's translated to writing, is the word grapho in Greek. And it could be translated to write against. To write against somebody. So I don't know for sure what he wrote, but I did come up with a interesting prophecy. Steve was talking about prophecies earlier. In Jeremiah, in chapter 17, verse 13, if you're taking notes, there's a prophecy that says, O Lord, the hope of Israel, all who forsake you will be put to shame. Those who turn away will be written in the dust because they have forsaken the Lord, the spring of living water. Did you get that? Their names will be written in the dust. So maybe Jesus was writing people's names. He could have been writing Shlomo or something of that nature or whatever name you want to pick. He could have been writing that person's name and said a certain date and just, hey, this guy committed adultery. How did he know? How did Jesus know that? Well, we don't, like I said, we don't know for sure what he wrote, but he did write something. Verse number 7. So when they continued asking him, he raised himself up and said to them, he who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first. Notice that they just didn't ask him one time. It says they continued asking him. They continued asking him. I'm guessing these guys probably had stones already in their hands, and they were ready to fast track this right there and that, you know, right here and there. You know, that mob mentality, the lynch mob mentality. That's what I think they were having. And then Jesus just, you know, didn't say anything, and he stoops down again without saying anything. And that's called a strategic pause. If you ever listen to any of the studies that Pastor Chuck Smith does, it's like, he'll be talking and teaching, and then all of a sudden it just gets quiet. It's like, did my tape player or did my player stop? No, he'll just pause for a minute and let you think about it. And that's what Jesus did. He just paused, and he let this sink in for just a little. He let their anger swell for a minute. Verse number 8, and again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. Verse 9, then those who heard it, being convicted by their conscience, okay, we got something wrong here. I might know. Then those who heard it, being convicted by their conscience, went out one by one, beginning with the oldest to the last, and Jesus was left alone and the woman standing in the midst. And back in verse 7, so they continued asking him. He raised up himself and said, he who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first. The word for sin right there in the original language is a word called anamatartos. And the word could be translated to one who has no sin, the one who could not sin, and the one that has no desire to sin. So Jesus is saying to them, you don't have the qualifications to throw the first stone. The only one who does have the qualification to throw the stone is Jesus. Everyone else has got sin. He changes the issue right then and there. He changes the issue from a legal issue to a spiritual issue. It's not an argument anymore about the Mosaic law or the seventh commandment. It's not an argument anymore about Roman law versus Jewish law. Jesus is saying, you lack the qualifications to throw the rocks. Remember in the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus was speaking, he said, "You have heard that it said that you shall not commit adultery." But Jesus said, if you even look at a woman with lust, you've already committed adultery in your heart. So everyone is guilty of that. Everyone's guilty of committing adultery. Jesus is meek with people, but he's masterful with hypocrites, and he's merciful with sinners. Verse number 10, when Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her, "Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?" Notice that Jesus waited until everybody else was gone before he confronted this woman. He didn't call her out in the middle of the crowd like he could have. He didn't call her any names. He could have called her a harlot or something worse like that. But Jesus deals with people one-on-one. That's why we always say it's important to have a personal relationship with Christ. Notice also that he calls her woman. That's a title of respect. That's the same word that Jesus used to call his mother back in John chapter 2 at the wedding at Cana. He called his mother woman. That's a title of respect. And he says, "Has no one condemned you?" Verse number 11. She said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said to her, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." The only one qualified to throw the stones didn't have a stone in his hand. Well, some people, after they read this story, they might think, well, Jesus is awful easy on sinners. Easy on sin. No, he wasn't easy on sin. He called it sin. He didn't call it a hang-up. He didn't call it an alternative lifestyle. He called it sin. What is sin? Sin is an offense against God. He called it sin. He wasn't condoning her lifestyle. He didn't say, "Oh, I don't condemn you. Go and try not to sin no more." He said, "I don't condemn you. Go and sin no more." He didn't tell her to stop the lifestyle that's marking her, and that was the sin of adultery. Why would he say that? Well, any encounter with Jesus should follow a transformation. If you're a true believer in Christ, there should be some transformation in your life. The sign of a believer is the transformation. You know, I think it's sad when you might hear some Christians say, "Oh, I know this is wrong, but I'm going to go ahead and do it anyway because I can always repent later." Really? The Apostle Paul tells us, should we continue to sin so that grace can abound? No, certainly not. Certainly not. This lady gets a second chance. Notice how sin, notice again also in the story how sinners treat other sinners. Sin that looks so bad on somebody else, but it never looks as bad on ourselves. Isn't that how it always is? Notice how Jesus sets the standard, the law sets the standards, but it can't cleanse your soul. The law can't save you. It just sets the standard to show you that you are a sinner and that you do need Christ. Notice how Jesus treats sinners. One of my favorite verses in the Bible, whenever I screw up and then the enemy's like trying to constantly remind me, "Oh, you screwed up, you're not worthy." Romans 8:1 is my go-to verse on that. There's now no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Whenever the devil's trying to whisper that into your ear, that you're a screw-up and you're not worthy, just remind him that there's no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. So how can a person be righteous and a sinner at the same time? Well, righteousness and mercy meet at the cross. It's called substitutionary atonement. That means that Christ took your place on the cross. He was the sacrifice. He paid the penalty for your sin. That's how Christ treats sinners. She was caught and brought to Jesus, and Jesus blotted her sins out. Jesus looked at this immoral woman with compassion. She is the one whom he died on the cross for, and he's also the one that died on the cross for you. That's pretty much the first story in this section of Scripture. Now we'll move on to the next one. Verse number 12 begins a new dialogue. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of light." This is the This is the second of the seven I am statements. If you had been with us a few weeks ago, we got to the first of the I am statements. There are seven statements in the Gospel of John where Jesus says, I am something. I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door of the sheep gate. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection of the life. I am the way and the truth and the life. And then he says, I am the true vine. Those are the seven I am statements. But here he says, I'm the light of the world. And you'll notice I've got light of the world highlighted there because that's an I am statement. But let's think a little bit if you were here last week. Last week we were talking about the Feast of Tabernacles. The Feast of Tabernacles is now over by one day. What did the Feast of Tabernacles represent? It represented the time that the Jewish nation was wandering in the wilderness. And when they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years, what did they have that guided them through the wilderness? They had a pillar of cloud, and then they had a light. They had a light. Well, Jesus is saying that he's that light. Did you know, according to the way the Jews thought 2,000 years ago, that there was only one person that the term light was reserved for? You know how I know that? Here's a couple of examples of that. They knew exactly what Jesus was saying when he said he was the light of the world. They knew that he was claiming deity. And here's one example. In Psalm 27, verse 1, it says, the Lord, Yahweh, is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Did you get that? The Lord, I put Yahweh in parentheses there because where it says Lord in all uppercase letters like that, that's the word that's translated Yahweh. And that's the name of God. Here's another example if you're taking notes. Isaiah 60, verse 19 says, the sun shall no longer be your light by day, nor for brightness shall the moon give light to you, but the Lord, Yahweh, will be to you an everlasting light, and your God your glory. Did you get that again? The Lord is the light. Here's one more. Micah 7, 8. Do not rejoice over me, my enemy. When I will fall, I will arise. When I sit in darkness, the Lord, Yahweh, will be a light to me. So they knew right away that Jesus was claiming deity. If anyone ever comes up to says to you, well, Jesus never claimed to be God. Oh, yes, he did. Even his enemies knew that he did. When you read through the scriptures here. I hope you know that John is trying to show you over and over and over in this gospel that Jesus is God in a human body. Verse 12. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. Do you see that? Jesus says, I am the light of the world. But later on, he's going to say, you are the light of the world. In the Gospel of Matthew, in chapter 5, Jesus says, you're the light of the world. So which one is it? Well, while Jesus was here on earth, he's the light of the world. But now that he's not on earth anymore, you know what? You're the light of the world. I've always liked the little story about a little boy that just moved from the country into a city, and his mom took him to this huge cathedral on a Saturday. And they were looking at all these beautiful stained glass windows in this cathedral. And on these windows, there was these images of people. And the little boy asked his mom, he said, Who is that? He said, oh, those are saints. Those are saints up there on those windows. Those are drawings of saints in those stained glass windows. And he thought, oh, that was pretty cool. Well, the next day, the little boy's in Sunday school class at church, and the teacher asked him, hey, can anybody tell me what a saint is? And the little boy raised his hand. He goes, oh, I can tell you what a saint is. A saint is somebody that light shines through. Isn't that really a cool definition? A saint is somebody that light shines through. You might say, well, I don't feel like a saint. Well, you are a saint. If you've accepted Christ by faith, the Bible says you're a saint. Sometimes people get that word saint confused in the definitions because of what happened in the Roman Catholic Church. They think, well, a saint has to be somebody that's dead and then the church voted and they approved them and now they're a saint. But that's not what the Bible teaches. The Bible teaches that you're a saint once you've accepted Christ by faith. It's not because you're a good person. It's because Christ was the good person and you've accepted his righteousness. Verse 13. Then the Pharisees therefore said to him, you bear witness of yourself. Your witness is not true. Verse 14, Jesus answered and said to them, even if I bear witness of myself, my witness is true, for I know where I came from and where I'm going, but you do not know where I come from and where I'm going. You judge according to the flesh. I judge no one. Remember John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. What's the next verse? Because we always forget about John 3:17. Well, Jesus didn't come into the world to condemn the world. He came in the world to save the world. Verse 16. And yet, if I do judge, my judgment is true, for I am not alone, but I am with the Father who sent me. It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one who bears witness of myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness of me. Then they said to him, where is your Father? Jesus answered, you know neither me nor my Father. If you had known me, you would have known my Father. They're trying to insult him right there. If you're not catching that, when they're asking, where is your Father? Because later on we'll see in one of the other verses where they accuse him of being born out of fornication. They're claiming right then, where is your Father? We thought Joseph was your Father. Well, Jesus is saying, no, that God is my Father. He's also saying right then and there that if you don't know Jesus, you don't know God. So every other religion out there, or every cult or whatever, and they want to put Jesus on the back burner and say that he wasn't God in a human body. Jesus saying right there, you don't even know who God is. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. Well, that sounds kind of narrow, doesn't it? Well, Jesus also said that narrow is the gate that leads to everlasting life, and broad is the road that leads to destruction. Verse 20. These words Jesus spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple, and no one laid hands on him, for his hour had not yet come. We had talked about this statement, my hour has not yet come, where Jesus is on this divine timetable. You'll see later on that his hour, which means not just an hour of time, it's a time of his ministry. When he gets ready to go to the cross, that's when he say, my hour has come. Verse 21, then Jesus said to them again, I am going away, and you will seek me, and you will die in your sin. Where I go, you cannot come. You're going to die in your sin. Isn't that the worst way to die? The worst possible way to die that I could think of would be to die in your sin. So the Jews said to him, will he kill himself because he says, where I go, you cannot go? If you didn't know this, 2,000 years ago, the Jews thought that if you killed yourself, if you committed suicide, that God was going to send you to the hottest part of hell. Well, so what they're saying is that Jesus must be going to kill himself. He's going to go to hell. That's why we're not going to be able to go where he's going. Because they believed, since they were descendants of Abraham, they believed that every Jew was going to go to heaven just because they were a Jew. It didn't matter how they lived or not. It's just the fact that they were a Jew. Also, notice that Jesus is very meek when he replies to them, when he says, I am going away, and you will seek me, and you will die in your sins. Where I go, you cannot follow. He's not trying to be harsh with them. He's just telling them the truth. One other thing that you might notice right here, these scribes and Pharisees, they think they're righteous, but they're not righteous. They just think they are. You know, they're self-righteous. Self-righteousness can be the worst kind of false religion there is out there. If you think you can save yourself, that's the worst kind of thing. Even Apostle Paul told Timothy, when he wrote to Timothy, that he wrote and told Timothy that he was the chief of sinners. We think, wow, Apostle Paul, he was a great Christian, a great missionary, but he says to himself about Timothy, to Timothy, that he's the chief of sinners. You know, there's only one kind of righteousness that God is going to accept, and that's the righteousness that comes from Christ, not the righteousness that comes from you. Verse 23, he said to them, you are from beneath, I am from above. You are of this world, I am not of this world. The word for world right there is the Greek word cosmos that's translated to world. It doesn't just mean the planet. It means the world system. It's an order of ideas or values. What Jesus is telling you right there, if you're opposed to God, you're not from this world. You're from the other guy. Because the Bible tells us that the God of this world is Satan. Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians that if the gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the god of this age, which is Satan, has blinded them. And also notice that Jesus is telling all this stuff to religious people, people that think that they're right with God. Therefore, I said to you that you will die in your sins. If you do not believe that I am He, you will die in your sins. If you have a New King James Bible that you're looking at right there, if you'll notice the word He, the word He right there is in italics. The reason that it's in italics is that word was added by the translators. That was the predicate added by the translators. It really says, for you do not believe that I am, you will die in your sins. Does that word sound, those two words sound familiar to you? The words I am? That's the same words that the voice in the burning bush spoke to Moses back in the book of Exodus. But this is in Greek right now. The New Testament was translated to English from Greek. But there's also an Old Testament translation out there that was translated in about 200 BC called the Septuagint. Maybe some of you are familiar with that. That's the Old Testament translated to Greek. So if you read Exodus in the Septuagint, it's going to use the same word, I am. Ego amin is the Greek word. It's the same two words right there. So Jesus is saying right this, right here and now. He says, if you do not believe that I am, you will die in your sins. Verse 25. Then they said to him, who are you? Jesus said to them, just what I have been saying to you from the beginning. Beginning of what? From the beginning of verse 12 when he started this dialogue right then and there. Let me back up to verse 24 just a minute again where it says if. That's another one of those if clauses there. If you do not believe, you're going to die in your sins. If you do not believe that Jesus is who he said he was. So what does it mean to believe? Believe means to put your faith, hope, and trust in Jesus. It's not just to believe that Jesus was a good guy or that Jesus lived here on earth, because James tells us in the book of James that even the demons believe in Jesus, but they're not the one that's being saved. Verse 26, I have many things to say and to judge concerning you, but he who sent me is true, and I speak to the world those things which I heard from him. Jesus is saying that he had to learn things from God. He was still fully man and fully God, but he had to learn those things directly from God. He heard God say those things, and that's why he knows them. Verse 27, they did not understand that he spoke to them of the Father. Not knowing the Son is not knowing the Father. I'm just repeating myself. If you don't know the Son, you don't know the Father. Then Jesus said to them, when you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am He, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father taught me, I speak these things. There again, I've got He in italics, because that word is not there in the original language. It was added by the translators. It literally says, then you will know that I am when you lift up the Son of Man. What is he talking about when he says, lift up the Son of Man? Is he talking about when we sing praise songs, we lift Jesus' name up? That's not what he's talking about right there. He's talking about being lifted up on a cross and dying for the sins of the world. Back in John chapter 3, when Jesus talked about putting the snake on the pole, and when the snake was lifted up in the air, and the people looked at it and they were healed. And then Jesus said, When I'm lifted up, I will draw all men to me. He's referring to the cross. So, when Jesus died on the cross, and he died, did anybody know that he was the I am when that happened? Well, yes, he did. There were some people standing there that did know that Jesus was the Son of God. Think about the guy that was dying next to Jesus, that we call the thief on the right side of Jesus. He knew. He knew that Jesus was who he said he was. Remember, he said, Jesus, remember me when you go into your kingdom. And Jesus said, from this day you'll be with me in paradise. Also, the Roman soldiers that killed Jesus, that crucified him, remember when the sky turned black? They said, oh, truly this man was the Son of God. And this also could be referring to a prophecy. There's a prophecy in Zechariah 12:10. Because not all the Jews right here and there did believe in Jesus when he died on the cross. But there's a prophecy in Zechariah 12. It says that they'll look at him on whom they've pierced. I believe that's a prophecy coming in the later on, when all the Jews, when Paul tells us that all of Israel will be saved, they're going to know that Jesus is the Messiah. And I believe that's referring to that prophecy right there. Verse 29. And he who sent me is true. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do the things that please him. Wouldn't that be nice if you could make that statement also? I always do the things that please the Father. As he spoke these words, many believed in him. Then Jesus said to those Jews who believed in him, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. If. The if clause is another one of those conditional promises, conditional statements. Not everybody's Jesus' disciples. You can say, oh, I'm Jesus' disciples, but if your lifestyle doesn't show it, if you don't, what does it mean to abide in his word? To keep his word. If you're not keeping his word and you're living for yourself, you're not picking up your cross and following Jesus. Remember, Jesus also said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and you don't do what I say? So this is a conditional statement. Verse 32. This is going to be our last verse of today. I put the end of verse 31 on there also because I want you to be able to read this in context. Because verse 32, most of you know this verse. It's a very famous verse. It says, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. This verse, standing on alone by itself, is taken out of context more often than you can possibly imagine. You know, there's even universities, secular universities, that have this verse engraved on stones at the university, saying, if you know the truth will set me free. Well, that's completely out of context, because you have to go back one more sentence to understand what Jesus is really saying. He's saying, if you abide in my word. That's conditional. You're not going to know the truth if you're just some Joe Blow out here on the street and you're not one of Jesus' disciples. You've got to be one of his disciples. You know, in this postmodern society that we live in today, truth has become very relative. If you go to a secular college today, the secular professors are going to tell you that you can't know the truth. One thing they know for sure, this is one thing that they know for sure today. Postmodernists are absolutely certain that nothing is absolutely certain. You get that? They're absolutely certain that nothing is absolutely certain. So if you tell somebody, I know the truth, they're going to think you're very intolerant. You're going to fail. Today, if you're going to a secular college, they're going to tell you that the ultimate goal that you can achieve is to be tolerant of everyone. If you say you know the truth, they're going to think you're closed and narrow-minded. But Jesus said, if you're truly my disciple, you'll know the truth and the truth will set you free. So what is the truth? What truth is he talking about? He's talking about if you don't believe that I am who I am, you're going to die in your sins. That's the truth he's referring to. In closing, I want you to think about one more thing. I want you to back up just a minute into the first story that we talked about. We talked about Jesus and the woman caught in adultery, and where Jesus wrote something in the ground. When I did this study on that portion of Scripture, I did some research on writing and things that are written. You know, there's a lot of important documents out there that we have copies of. If you have, you know, some of the documents, some of the letters that Abraham Lincoln wrote, they're very valuable. If you have some copies of the Declaration of Independence, or maybe some copies of the Constitution and those kind of things, those are considered extremely valuable documents. But I found the most valuable document that you could get a hold of right now to this day is if you have something written by William Shakespeare. Say you got it in your closet at home. You've got an original signature of William Shakespeare. You know that it's worth $5 million? That's the secular terminology. But in my opinion, I think the most valuable thing ever written was what Jesus wrote in the ground that day in the dust of the temple. And it's blown away 2,000 years ago. And it gave this woman a second chance. And he's given you that second chance today. So today, if you don't know him and you don't truly abide in his word, what's stopping you from today. Make that decision today. Don't let tomorrow, wait till tomorrow, because today's the day of salvation. Tomorrow is not promised to any one of us. So this morning, there's going to be some people in this corner back here that want to pray with you. If you'd like to have some individual prayer and you'd like to recommit your life to Christ today, I just want to encourage you to get up and meet in this corner, and we'll lay hands on you and we'll pray for you. Let's stand and bow our hearts in prayer. Father God, we just thank you and praise you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your gift of your son. Father God, as we leave this place this morning, Father, I just pray that you would wrap your arms around each and every one of us, Father God. Fill us with your Holy Spirit as we leave this place today, Father. As we move into this Passover season, today is Palm Sunday, as we know, Father God. We can use that as conversation starters throughout the week with the unsaved world, Father God, because we are the saints. We are the one that the light shines through. And Father, I just pray that the unbelieving world would see that light in us today and every day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.
Sing that part again.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat.